Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Welcome to the planning board meeting for Monday, March 13th, 2017. Thank you, HCAM, for videoing the meeting. We are, is it down, what, one member?
Two
members.
John and Fran.
And so the video, because we have a public hearing that we will be continuing, that they'll have to look at the tape to, in order to do the vote on this. The agenda is fairly light tonight with everyone's expectations. That I understand that Kobe and Jen have taken wagers on whether or not we're going to get out at an early time or not today. And I'm hoping that they're both all win.
It's on TV.
And
part of the public record.
So basically, we have one public hearing, and then we have a lot of miscellaneous small stuff that'll go pretty quickly. The other thing in the opening remarks, I'd like to bring it up, is people are starting to receive their invitations to the Legacy Farms road opening. It is currently slated on March 21st at 9:30 a.m. The public is invited. We've also invited approximately 200 or so other folks, including as many of the past and present board and committee members that have participated in Legacy Farms meetings. And we're hoping at the conclusion of this, after a couple of short speeches, because it'll probably be a chilly day, that we will have a ribbon cutting, and we ask everyone that wants to come to help cut us, help cut the meat, the ribbon. So please bring a pair of scissors with you. So we're hoping to line up 100 and something people, or maybe whatever will want to take part, and we'll do that. The ribbon cutting will be, the site is at Franklin Road and Legacy North, and that's where we'll start. There's going to be parking right across the street from that in the commercial sales yard of Western Nurseries, provided that we can get it plowed, or depending on what the weather conditions are going to be on. I did receive a call from Roy McDowell this morning. He is concerned with the weather event tomorrow and what the weather might be for the next couple of days as to whether or not we shouldn't postpone this or not. I said I would consult with our DPW director, John, who happens to be here, and also see what tomorrow actually brings, and we'll probably make a decision on that. If we had to, we would do it to like the first week of April, but there's a few things that need to be coordinated for that to happen. It looks like the 21st, the weather is going to be relatively good compared to what tomorrow is going to bring. So, with all that, I'd like to open the public hearing for 74 Main Street. This is an additional parking spaces. It's a minor site plan review. This is a proposed addition to the parking lot in front of the police headquarters. So, we have an outline that we typically use on these type of things, and we're going to kind of follow through that. There are several portions where, like, detailed discussions that if there are any members of the public, which I see very few today, want to comment, they are more than welcome. But David, why don't you make the presentation on behalf of the town?
Okay, thank you. Thank you for getting me on the agenda. I want to apologize for kind of sending a new revised plan just today. Thanks to Jennifer. The original site plan application just had six spaces without a handicap spot. The original thought process for this parking lot was to just try to think of it as a separate parking lot from the police station. We went to the Board of Appeals because there's a variance required. There's no parking is allowed between the building and Main Street. And there was some discussion from that board about, you know, providing a handicap spot. when you take into account all the spots in the police station, it does warrant another handicap spot, another accessible spot. So on behalf of the town, decided, you know, it would make be more beneficial to just provide that spot. It's more of a, you know, not only the code required, but you know, just a right thing to do. Town meeting passed funds for this last year to construct it and design it. The intent was to, as part of a larger, you know, two-pronged downtown corridor project, as well as providing, you know, parking, as much parking in the downtown area as possible. The parking lot in this area, you know, should the downtown corridor come to fruition, you know, kind of a one-to-one swap for some of the spots that are going to have to be lost in this area due to some bike paths and the widening of the road. So it's really the intent is to swap out those spaces for these businesses, so, you know, to minimize the hardship to those businesses. And overall, from a town standpoint, you know, it's working with your board, the Board of Selectmen, Town Hall, and just providing more parking in the downtown area. Some of those efforts include your board's, you know, requirements for parking on Walcott Street, the parking for the library, the town signing a lease with St. John's Church to allow parking in their area. So there's a global kind of effort here to increase parking in this area. So kind of a quick synopsis there.
Okay. One of the things I maybe didn't make clear to members of the board, because he didn't get his zoning variance, and there's, I think, paperwork that was in there talking about that, we can't do the final vote tonight. I'm hoping to get to the point, because I haven't seen a lot of public members in the room here speaking against it, that we're going to get to everything but the vote, so that we can kind of get through most of the detailed discussion tonight, and then, provided that the Board of Appeals then approves the variance, then we'll be all set with a quick vote at our, one of our following meetings. So that's what the plans are. So, Jennifer, do you have comments?
I don't really have any comments at this time, but as we go through the outline, I can provide some additional information for some of the items if needed.
Okay. We're now on item three, where planning board members and the public can add to the outline. This is one of the simplest projects I think that we as a board have undertook approval of in a long, long time. So I think we've got things pretty well covered, unless anyone else has something else they want to add to it.
I would just add, I forgot to mention, we've gone through confirmation, okay. And they've approved the permitting for the project.
Okay, so basically I think we're on to, unless I see any additional discussion items, let's just kind of go through the detailed discussion, of which members of the public are more than welcome to talk on. First one is traffic. We, of course, didn't ask for a traffic study on something this minor. I suspect the traffic is already there. We're just changed where they're going to park. I mean, it's not like we've got a new building, Frank.
He did mention one thing about traffic, though, the changes to downtown taking away parking spaces on the street. I would prefer to approach this project maybe with blinders on, but as separate from the traffic study, and more for what additional parking could be added. Because I don't think the parking spaces that are being removed, I don't think that's set in stone yet.
No, I kind of in intent is, should that project come to fruition? That's one of the advantages of creating. Globally, the town has been trying to just provide more parking in general in downtown area. So,
and it's pretty clear, almost every iteration I've seen of the plan that Dave's working on, we're losing spots right in that area because we're adding lanes and everything else. So it's, and I think I agree with what Frank's premise is, that we need as much parking as we can get because that's what the businesses need. And I think everyone on that same page with that. But, and this is a small step, but I'll say for the package store and maybe the barber shop across the street and a couple of the other businesses right there, these six spots are a big deal, I think. Okay, so traffic, we're all set. David, why don't you explain what you're doing with stormwater?
The stormwater, we're more or less tying into the existing system. There's an existing storm drain system for the police station. They have a detention basin in the back. The consultant, Weston & Sampson, reviewed the original calculations, provided new calculations for the increased in impervious area through the RDA, through the Conservation Commission, and the increase in the runoff can be handled by the existing system. They can be tied in by gravity connection. So it's pretty basic, basically just tying into the old original.
Basin.
Yeah, one catch basin for the parking lot.
Anyone have questions?
I have one.
Go ahead, Cliff.
Wouldn't it be, without stipulation, that it was already designed to take stormwater anyway from this? So why are we talking about additional stuff when, because of hard packed surface, I understand, but I think the road kind of, the entrance kind of carries that along the way anyway, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, whenever you're adding, the original police station design was based on just the specific square footage of pervious area and impervious area, and it's designed specifically under those guidelines. When you add impervious area in the hard top, I mean, you will get that additional runoff. It's not a whole lot of space, but that extra increase in runoff, volume of flow, and the cubic foot discharge into this new system, you have to add that into your outlet.
Overall, right.
And then the original, they make sure the original catch, original detention basin was had a
margin of error,
safety factor built into it, so that little extra. One CFS isn't going to inundate the existing.
So to that point, is there going to be, like, it sounds like when you're making these proclamations that there's a cost associated to doing that kind of work.
I think what I'm hearing is he's running a short pipe to go from one catch basin to another catch basin, and then using the existing pipe to get to the back.
Yeah, we're tying into an existing drain manhole at the corner of the police station with a new catch basin.
So do you know the cost associated with that?
I don't. The total cost of that specific putting in a catch basin and 130 feet of pipe might be, $7,500 or something, $10,000 in that range.
Okay. And the only reason why I ask that is because, we have allocated a whole lot of funds, and if we're putting more on top of more, that's the only thing that I'm concerned about.
I think the engineers have done a good design for it,
sure,
and they're doing it right, and that's all we can ask.
I have a question through the chair. And a comment on our member's statement. I agree about we should keep an eye on cost, and functionally, I have no problem with the plan. Is this something that the DPW can implement, or does it have to be a third-party contractor involved to do the project? I'm looking at it for to be the most affordable way to get this accomplished.
Well, we can ask John or David to answer it, but I'll take a stab at it real quick. Is we don't have a lot of staff on our DPW per se, and we don't have a construction team as part of that. We have a repair team. But it might be simpler to hire a small contractor to get it done and get it done quickly.
It's correct. I mean, this DPW usually doesn't do utility construction work as some towns do, but they sometimes have those construction crews on site. There's two appropriations that's being funded. There's another small project that we're kind of tying into this for an economy of scale. Kent's will have one contractor do both projects. There's some resurfacing going on in the back. There's a previous town meeting approved funds for both of them. So we are going to be saving funds on both of these. The original was, I think, $75,000 and maybe $35,000 for the back. The estimates are coming in below that. We're going to be doing some of the on-site inspection ourselves, so we minimize the consultant's time on staff during construction. So, and we haven't done a project yet that we've had to you know, we went over budget. Everything we've done is always kind of under budget. So
okay, so let's check off the stormwater at this point. And we're on the parking lot design. I think we just really had snow storage and handicap parking. And we have a proposed condition, which is typical for that, that if you get too much snow, like maybe tomorrow, that you got to haul it away, which is what the town does a pretty good job of anyway. We're probably better off than most of our private lots right around here, because we do have the equipment to do that. So I that's a typical question, but
I mean, I will confirm with DPW, but I know they already have the old operations for the police station parking lot, and I'll just, you know, for the next meeting, just have confirmation from DPW that they'll add the snow removal for these spaces.
And then
or not.
And handicap parking, did we get enough of an explanation, members of the board, on that already?
Can I just ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
Can you point out where the existing two are located?
Thank you.
Yes. In the existing parking lot, just north of the proposed one, you have that little striped area.
Yes.
To each side is an accessible spot. To the left side is a van accessible spot. And for the top, I should say, and the bottom spot is an accessible spot as well.
And we have a total...
The total on site is 53, I believe, now with these new six spots.
My question would be, the new handicap spot, would it be better served in the back of the building instead of the front of the building?
Well, the back of the building is not a public parking area. It's police operations mostly. Once you start getting public, in discussions with the police, we start allowing parking in the back by public and kind of get in the way of their emergency operations.
But we're using that in the ratio for the amount of handicap spots we
Correct.
Need.
Correct.
That doesn't seem right.
It's a mixture of state law and
Well, the spots in front here are intended for the public and the staff of the building.
No, but I mean...
I don't think we hire too many policemen that are... maybe there's... That's some kind of discrimination or whatever, but I want kind of an able guy that can run.
There's other positions in the police department.
Maybe it's not the chair. Yeah. Maybe it's not a public, I mean, a working handicap. Maybe it's a public working
Well,
handicap.
These are public lots, and that's right where he said.
Maybe I can clarify my question a little
Sure.
bit. So the 14 spots in the front, what is required for handicap?
If it was just 14 spots themselves, it might be zero, maybe one.
No. So why?
I'm not on 14 is the 15 so triggers your 15 first. Triggers
so 15.
Your first,
yeah. I mean, I'm not sure why we're adding another handicap spot.
Because of the total.
Because of the total on the site. It's the total on the site.
Right.
And these six trigger the additional one. And so the building commissioner, who has the authority to regulate handicap parking spaces, has determined because these six trigger the additional one of them has to be handicap accessible.
To his point, his question then, why can't the handicap parking for the police department go to the back, as he clearly asked in the first question, was that we've got three handicap parking spaces out front now.
Well, I believe...
Four, actually, with a van.
The locations of your handicap spots by law need to be as close to the building as possible. The parking in back would not be as close to, you know...
Well, there's a back entrance to the police station.
It may not be fully accessible. And there's no elevator access back there. So, I mean, the front entrance is your accessible entrance for accessible. Your elevator's there for that specific reason. Regulations require your parking, your accessible parking. You make it as easy as possible to get from point A into the building from your accessible standpoint.
Question through the chair.
I
understand and accept that one additional space is being created, but I'm a little confused by the drawing. You said the additional loading space for, say, a wheelchair could be used by the left or right side. So will there be just one handicap sign or two handicap signs?
For the new spot?
Yeah, I believe it's just going to be one from the landscape that we got today, but...
correct.
For your explanation, maybe, I'm just not sure what...
For the new lot, we're proposing one space to be, you know, to
one
the
space,
left.
One sign.
Yes, to the left of the stripe area.
Which could be used from either side. You don't...
I mean, a handicap accessible...
folks
can use...
doesn't have to
They
park
can
the
use whatever
space.
Spot they would like, correct.
Right. Okay.
But the designated spot would be, you know, with signage and with
north.
The striping,
okay.
would be to the north.
Thank you.
Sure.
Okay, other questions on the design of the parking lot? I have one more.
I also have one.
Okay, Goo, go ahead first.
Just looking at the little peninsula between the two, the old part, the existing parking lot and the new to be constructed parking lot, why are we only doing six spaces? Why are we not choosing to add a seventh space? I mean, parking downtown is such a problem.
I think he answered this last time about trees.
Well, there is an existing tree there, and I know we're trying to minimize the impact to, you know, landscaping and in the original design of the building. There's also to try to create a separation from, you know, in discussions with the police, you know, these spots were always originally intended to be for police business and not as
the,
much.
The eight existing.
Yeah, not,
I agree.
Not as
not,
much.
I'm not saying we take away
right.
that peninsula.
So what it provides is you have a natural buffer there that keeps the public from kind of transferring into that
space. It also
kind
of gives us our 10% factor in the parking lot design, too. So,
I think it's probably more aesthetic. Probably only get, you might only get one or two more spots.
I was just asking, why not add a seventh? I mean, I guess you could add an eighth, but,
yeah.
I mean, if we're talking about potentially taking away parking on the street, none of those are handicap spots. Mm. And if we're taking away six non-handicap spots, why wouldn't we add six non-handicap spots? Just a question.
I understand. This fit into the existing landscaping the best. What cost would have to add additional cost, would have to add removal of a I think it's a 10-inch or 12-inch tree that's there.
Chairman, I'd like to suggest that maybe if you could take a look at that, because it sounds like a good idea, because... I mean, that handicap spot is kind of off-limits to everybody else, so that really is playing five general-use spots. So getting that six on the other side, still keeping the peninsula as a separation barrier and leaving the tree.
I mean, we wouldn't be able to leave the tree.
Is it right smack in the middle?
No, it's more towards the proposed parking lot.
Brian's suggesting adding one on the other side than the police use side.
The intent isn't for this existing to be public parking. In coordination with with the police department, you know.
Right.
Parking in here does impact their operations.
If you wanted to keep it on this side.
We're trying to minimize the cost of doing this. There's an electrical outlet over here, too. It's not shown on the plan, which would have to move. So it's just kind of another level of an extra $5,000, $6,000 to the project. Maybe not that much.
Okay.
And you're planning on just a follow-up?
Go ahead.
But you said earlier you think you'd be under budget.
Well, we're trying to save as much money as possible, not spend to the limit. Is kind of the intent. And plus, this is what was presented at town meeting. I don't want to change the scope of it too much, but
that's fine.
Okay. My question is: does your plan also include like a big blue P parking sign somehow?
We're going to have some. A public notification, notification program, notification open of a new municipal kind of a lot. But yes, it's going to be intended for to notify the public.
But to signify that
it's a municipal.
Is public.
Yes.
Yeah. I think that kind of helps. I mean, quite frankly, there's nobody is going to throw somebody out if you go park in one of the police lots. And I've parked there going several times to pick up stuff, and those eight spots are normally not used except for when the police department has like marathon coordination meetings. They don't have enough spots anywhere to park.
That's why it's going to be intended, because sometimes the police do have a training facility that they'd like to try to use more. This helps provide some additional.
Yeah.
For those types of events, but we don't want to use it just for police.
Okay. Let's see. I think we're kind of done through the detailed discussion items, unless anyone else has more questions.
Lighting and screening? Or no?
I forgot screening. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Lighting, I believe you're not adding any new lights to it, so
no.
Therefore it's as lit as it is and will probably be lit from...
Will it be lit from the street?
Street lights.
Well, we have lights on the police property, just behind. You can, they're shown on the plan. They're actually pole lights. They're probably about 12.
They light up the driveway now, so they
yes,
probably cover
yeah.
the
they'll,
cover
they'll
that
cover
too.
The two. There's two of them within.
There's two within.
Right.
Oh, I see.
So it'll be lit up enough for walking traffic after hours.
And the existing, and we're going to be tying into the existing curb, existing sidewalk, which has post lighting on it.
So in the handicap aspect, that little concrete walkway matching existing scoring pattern, is that going to be lit up for people to walk with?
As much as the existing
two lights give?
Post, you have post lights along your
yeah, I see,
existing
I see
sidewalk.
Them on the...
This is the driveway that, or walkway that walks goes all the way up from the street.
Yeah, and there's a little bench area. There's actually that half moon.
Yeah, okay.
There's a little concrete area with a bench or something.
So that's my question there. Is that going to be lit up enough? Because that's a handicap accessibility.
I think it'll be lit up enough. But the existing
Got all these things that say post on it. Those are little lights.
Yeah, those are
lights.
Sidewalk bollard lights, as well as the lighting behind the parking lot along the driveway entrance.
There's enough light, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we're happy with lighting.
Yep.
Now there was a question on screening that I think particularly the ZBA wanted us to answer as one of their two questions. As far as I'm concerned, we've already answered. We have the information to answer on the handicap, which was their first question. The second one was on screening. I'd like to point out, I think I've heard that the police chief wants to make sure that he's got great visibility coming out of there, and that's his biggest concern. And I would suggest that adding any more screening, and there's no reason why we need to screen our police headquarters from the street. I mean, it's a beautiful building, and I don't think this parking area is going to detract from our streetscape to the point.
There is some low-lying shrubs along in front of the police sign there.
Sure.
Provide some screening for dogs walking by. Maybe, visually, it provides some screening.
Okay, so. I want to be very conscious that I can answer the questions by ZBA. So the screening, we're happy with minimal screening.
I would agree. It's fine.
I would agree. I think public safety is more important.
Okay. Okay. And so we've got, now I think we've got all the details stuff taken care of. Public comment. I don't see much there. Site plan standards. I believe Jennifer's memo went through that and met or comply with every one of our standards, mm-hmm. except for we need on H, we need ZBA approval, of which we will be getting that hopefully shortly. So, and then we're going to talk about conditions. I think, David, they're on page 4. Page 4. Site plan voting conditions. We talked about snow already, which is first one. Second one is you're going to do it nicely. No dirt and dust and all that good stuff, which you and remove your debris. And I don't think the Director of Municipal Inspection is going to need much help, but that's our typical one there. And that obviously construction hours. So there's nothing that we've really imposed that's
I took out the bond. I didn't think
we
would want
we do
bond.
Not bond ourselves. We're good at that.
I mean,
we know where David works, so we can go get him.
The contractor will still have a construction kind of performance and labor bonds.
Sure. So basically, we're on, I think, all the conditions.
Mm-hmm.
More public comment. I don't see any members here. Okay, you cannot vote on site plan approval tonight. However, I'd like to take a vote tonight that the project meets the requirements of a minor site plan project under section 210-134. And we meet that because... 136?
Yeah, 136.
Did I have it wrong in the memo?
Yeah. Oh, okay. And the board action said 134.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, it does.
So it's 136?
136.
Okay.
Maybe 134. Let me check.
Vote to determine project requires minor project under
236. Well, just checking out. One more question.
Sure, go ahead.
And I probably know the answer, but just to be sure, the online exchange area is in the current parking lot as it is, and there's camera, and that's all remaining the same?
Yeah, as far as I know. Unless police chief
134?
Change it.
Okay.
So 134?
That's newer, isn't it?
Last year?
Yeah. Because I quite frankly, I forgot until you just told me.
Entertain a motion to determine that the project meets the requirements of a minor project under 210-134.
So moved?
Moved.
Second.
Seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, so we are all the way through, and as soon as you come back with a ZBA approval.
When are you scheduled to meet with them again?
What?
I think I have to report back about this meeting, and then they'll set the next meeting. So it might be a month.
We have to schedule a date and time certain, though, here. Okay. So this is still an open public hearing.
Right.
They didn't give me a date.
They should have.
I thought they mentioned
the
letter.
Yeah, the letter did something.
Did it give a date in the letter?
Somebody looking for that?
Sorry.
Continue over March 22nd.
We're going to continue on 22nd, so our next meeting after that
March
is? Why don't we do it March 27th? David, as far as I'm concerned, you don't have to show up for this vote.
Oh.
Quite frankly. I mean, you know, I think
I was
we're...
trying to bring this, coffee or something.
unless the ZBA does something strange to change the plan. If they change the plan on you again, then, yeah, you ought to come back. But
okay.
If not, I think I'm seeing a consensus of it's a done deal by all of us. So I'd entertain a motion to continue the public hearing to March...
27th.
At 7:30.
So moved.
Second.
Yep. Thank you. Moved
seconded. How do you vote?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
David.
Good job. Okay. Next on the agenda, let me find out where I am. We have. We have John Westerling.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the Planning Board.
Before you get going on stormwater, give us the latest and greatest update on how much snow we're going to have to shovel tomorrow.
I recommend you reschedule the ribbon cutting.
Yeah.
If we're going to get anything like what they're calling for potential, which is, I've heard, 17 to 24 inches.
Okay, so sounds like we're in the sweet spot, huh?
Yeah, plus if we're going to be walking Legacy Farms North, no telling how well they're going to be plowing the snow there, how wide it's going to be, and what people will be able to see when they show up.
It's the first day of spring. March 21st.
Okay, so we have one recommendation for that, and we'll talk about it very shortly as a board where it is. But, okay. And we have... Well, we'll figure that out. Okay. So, we're talking about stormwater bylaw, and this is a general bylaw of which I think John is sponsoring the change.
Yes.
And he wants to kind of let us know what's going on.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And my apologies that we didn't have a draft ready for your packet, but I have it here tonight. I'm not expecting you.
You all got it.
Yeah. Beautiful. So I'm not expecting you to be fully familiar with it yet, but let me bring you up to speed on what this is and why it's required. First, as Ken mentioned, we do have an existing stormwater bylaw, which is well-crafted and meets the requirements of the new MS4 permit. Let me get a couple of acronyms out of the way. The first is NPDES, or NPDES. That's the National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System. And that's the permit that's issued by jointly by the EPA and MassDEP that authorizes us to discharge water into wetlands and streams. The second acronym is MS4, which stands for Municipal Separate Storm Sewer System. And that's basically the system of conveyances or pipes that are used to discharge stormwater. So that permit was approved last year, and it becomes effective July 1st of this year. And it's basically an update of the existing permit under which we currently operate, which requires us to clean catch basins, sweep the streets, and basically keep the drainage system in clear and clean.
Of which we're spending another $300,000 or $400,000, if I remember correctly, to comply with this federal requirement.
Correct. So the new law requires us to have something in place called an illicit discharge detection and elimination bylaw, or an IDDE. And basically, that is a bylaw that prohibits non-stormwater discharges into our stormwater system. And it also it allows us to have legal methods to be able to remove illicit connections into that system should we find them. An illicit discharge is a direct or indirect discharge to the municipal storm drainage system that is not composed entirely of stormwater, except as may be exempted in regulations. The term does not include a discharge in compliance with an NPDES stormwater discharge permit or discharges resulting from firefighting activities. Long story short, we have an existing bylaw. We need to add sections which allow us to investigate and find and remove illicit connections into our stormwater system. The new permit, which again takes place July 1st of this year, requires the town, and this is where the $300,000 comes into play, requires the town to sample all of our discharge points from our stormwater drainage system. It requires us, if we find pollutants in those discharges, to backtrack up through our stormwater system to find the source of it, and then to eliminate it, whether it's a spill, whether it's an illegal connection from a home, or whatever it is. We're required by this new law to make all of those inspections and take all those actions, which also requires testing of all of our discharges, dry weather inspections of those discharges, wet water inspections of those discharges. And so this is really the teeth which we will put into our existing bylaw, which give us those powers to inspect, to detect, to eliminate.
I have a question.
Go ahead, you with your question. Go ahead.
Okay, so I don't know if I should recuse myself from the board for a second because it pertains to my property.
No, it's a town-wide situation.
Okay, so I have a culvert in the back of my yard. Now, how does that affect that situation? If I approve what you're asking for, and we know that.
Well,
that
we're not going to vote on it tonight or anything.
Okay, all right.
So it's a town meeting vote. So you're not. Don't worry about. Just ask your question.
All right. So I'm concerned about how that plays into stormwater and the line of follow through.
Through the chair, are you connected into that culvert in any way? Do you have a physical connection of?
I have. That has to be there because the town buried my land.
But you don't have a sump pump connected to it, or?
No, but you have a pump there of some sort. You have a box pump of some sort there.
So what we will do as part of the new permit is we will have to inspect that visually during dry weather and wet weather. We'll also have to take samples during wet weather of the water that's coming from that, where it discharges, and if we find pollutants in it, then we must backtrack up through the catchment that's tributary to that pipe and find, for example, if we find human waste products, byproducts in the water, we've got to backtrack up through the stormwater system to find out, do we have a failed septic system? Do we have piles of dog waste? Anything like that, and eliminate them. So should we find a hit at the outlet of that existing culvert, we'll backtrack up. We'll move through your property and see if there's any problems there, any illicit discharges into the system. If not, then we continue to move back up through that system. So unless you have a physical connection there, or you have a failed septic system, or you know any other number of things, you should be fine. Like every other property across town that is near a roadway, near a catch basin, near a culvert, near a stream.
Okay, so to that point, I ask that it be noted that the reason why that culvert was put in there was because of the upbuilding of around my property.
Mm-hmm.
And if not, I would be a swimming pool.
Mm-hmm.
And that was put in there for the, just that intent and purpose, knowing that I was a Title V.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a leaching field that has to go through. And water runoff on that in that area goes directly through my yard because of the buildup. So I don't want to incur a cost associated to that situation due to the fact of this new law. And I feel strongly stating that grandfathered in, it's the town's responsibility to take care of that.
So through the chair, again, this is an illicit discharge detection and elimination. And the definition of illicit discharge is a direct or indirect discharge to the municipal storm drain system that is not composed entirely of stormwater. But so unless your septic system is failing and overflowing, then you're in violation of
health regulations. But it's not. It's not. But the thing is that we have a leaching field.
Which is absolutely fine, but your leaching field leaches into the groundwater. This is purely stormwater. So the water that would fall on your property or any other property that is low and would run across as stormwater into the culvert and out, or into a catch basin and out, all of those flows are absolutely fine. Unless we have, again, upstream a failed septic system, unless we have someone who has a sump pump that is pumping out into the street, any number of things which are a violation.
Okay, so I need to again reiterate the fact that it was put in for one intent and purpose, I believe.
Well, if there's a problem, then you'll have that other argument to be made.
Well, I don't want to pass anything unless I know that is under the stipulation.
Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It's a federal permit, and you're
well,
either
no,
compliant
we're
cha- or
we're
not.
We're changing laws right now.
We
Ken.
Are directed by the feds,
right,
and the state.
And I
or we shut all the stormwater down in town. That's the choice.
But that's not the choice.
No, it is the choice.
We're changing.
If I may, to the chair.
Yes.
I have a culvert on my property too, and the way I'm hearing this is it's looking for illicit materials, things that aren't supposed to be there.
I'm not going to give people approval to something like that.
Or people connecting to it. So like I'm concerned about like there's a storm drain on a street that culvert comes under my property because they built it up just like you guys. And what if someone's dumping radiator fluid out there? I mean, these guys will keep an eye on that, and they're tasked with detecting illicit materials. That's why I think that this zoning bylaw change is...
General
bylaw change gives it a little bit of teeth
a broader,
to deal with.
Yeah, a broader teeth to deep dig in and point the finger. Unfortunately... You know, we don't have anything in place to protect the people that have those culverts or anything, and they can incur an expense. I'm an advocate for that, but also for myself.
So again, as the chairman stated, this is a federal law, which is a permit to the town of Hopkinton.
But we're making amendment to our law.
We have to implement
which is already
the federal
on,
law.
We're already in compliance already.
No, you're not. You are not in compliance at this point because the federal law and the state, or the federal and the Fed EPA and the Mass DEP,
negotiated on the town's behalf for what the compliance is going to be. Actually, it was set down.
I'd like to see those papers that say that we're not in compliance.
So, as a little bit of background through the chair, again, this was the new permit, the MS4 permit, was approved last year. It becomes effective July 1st of this year. And the town, in order to comply with this, has to submit a new notice of intent. We have a current notice of intent under which we are permitted for our current MS4 permit, catch basin cleaning, street sweeping, and good housekeeping. So this requires that September of this year that we submit a new notice of intent, and by that time when we submit that notice, we must have an illicit discharge detection and elimination bylaw in place, which has to be approved by town meeting. So moving backwards through the calendar, we're required, it necessitates us to take this action at this May's town meeting.
Okay, so I'd like to see the paperwork that says the parameters of the scope I ask that I have enough time to read it to make sure that it complies to all the people that are pre-existing. Because I'm not going to let someone...
Let me tell you, Cliff, all the towns that have gone through this, everyone hates it because it's a federal requirement.
Ken, you can't just push something through just because you want it to go through.
No, I'm not pushing it through because I want it to go through. I'm saying it's got the power of the feds behind it.
Well, we're going to comply with the feds, but if there's a certain criteria that is encroaching upon pre-existing status, I want those people exempt from that status in order to make that viable for them not to have to incur a cost.
The reason the federal government has increased the regulations is they are trying to clean up the stream water in the state.
I understand why they would do it.
And they want everyone that is illicitly doing it to stop it.
And I understand that.
Okay, well, but somebody's going to pay for
it. There's a pre-existing status, like there is...
Okay, enough of the discussion.
No, it isn't enough of the discussion, Ken, because...
You go research the requirements.
No, I want that brought to me. I want that brought to me as a board member. Okay. It is my right to ask for that as a board member.
Question of clarification. Is it a federal law or federal regulation? Is it a regulation?
Regulation or a law?
I believe it comes out of the Clean Water Act.
We believe everything.
In compliance with the provisions of the Clean Water Act as amended, and the Massachusetts Clean Waters Act as amended, any operator of a small municipal separate stormwater system, which is the town of Hopkinton, is authorized to discharge in accordance with the conditions and the requirements set forth herein. And this is the new permit, which I will forward through Jennifer, that she can share with the entire planning board. So it looks at, again, an illicit discharge, and it defines illicit discharges as no person shall dump, discharge, spill, cause, or allow to be discharged any pollutant or non-stormwater discharge into the municipal separate storm sewer system.
Mr. Chair.
So what it does, if I may finish.
I'm sorry, I thought you were done.
No, I was taking a long pause. Okay. I can pause. So anyone now who currently has an illicit discharge, that has to be eliminated. If you're dumping waste oil into a catch basin, which gets into a stream, if you have a failed septic system that you're pumping across the grass, that has to be eliminated. So this gives us the teeth to be able to inspect for those, to go on a private property to inspect for those, and to eliminate those. Those should not be occurring today because they violate health regulations, conservation regulations, Clean Water Act.
So let me ask you to that point. If someone were to it be found on their property and it's coming from another property, what happens to the property that's in between where its source is and the people that are getting it through their source, through their property, and then discharging it out through the exit of that property? Who does the cleanup to the property that's in between?
So we have to find the source.
Once you find the source.
So I won't use you an example, that's a bad example. If I'm the source and it's going through John Doe's property, then I have an obligation to clean up John Doe's property. I have an obligation to stop discharging illicitly. I have an obligation to perhaps clean up the town's stormwater system, I have an obligation to clean up all the way downstream if it's a major pollutant. Mm-hmm. Whether I'm a business, a residence, anyone who is illicitly discharging, that's...
So could you answer that question you being directly?
The source. Right, you being the source.
So the source.
You being the source...
Is responsible.
I'm responsible.
So I have to... If my land needs to be fixed, and I'm using it because that's where I'm at right now, mm-hmm. and I go to the source, and they refuse to do that, it's on my own onus to acquire an attorney to get everything done and to get my yard cleaned up if need be.
That's how it is today.
Well, that sounds to me like it's not looked through for a pre-existing condition.
So you should, to the chair, you should support this then, I think, because this will allow the town to enforce the source to fine them until they fix it. So you should support this article.
As long as you're not doing anything wrong.
Yeah.
For example, I'm going to use your site specific.
Mm-hmm.
If the mobile gas station had a fuel spill,
mm-hmm.
and it went across your property into that culvert,
mm-hmm.
you as the intermediary property have no obligation. Mobile has an obligation to clean up, to stop the spill, to clean up your property where they polluted, to clean up the culvert, to clean up the wetlands. So they are responsible. With or without this bylaw, if that happened tomorrow, mobile gas station is still responsible to you as an abutter and private property.
And that's the derivative of why I'm bringing this question up. And it's not just me that has culverts in their yards. Mm-hmm. And through the source, if the source refuses to do anything, then the only recourse that we have as being billed to clean up a mess is to go after the source, which is an expense that is greatly incurred on the individual owner. Is that correct?
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
One, real quick, Cliff. Today, if that happens, what's your recourse?
The town, to bring it to the town.
Okay, and if the town passes this general bylaw, what's your recourse? Again, bring it to the town.
That
it's
now
the same.
It diverts it away
it's
from
the same.
No, it diverts it away from the town and puts it to the onus of the one that is causing the spill.
I'm hearing what Cliff is saying now. He's saying that he prefers it, or he understands it, that the town is responsible right now, no matter what. But I think what you're missing, Cliff.
The town's not responsible.
I think what Cliff is missing, though, is that this gives the town the power. More power to make sure that the source is responsible.
Right, so Cliff, today you go to the town, but the town isn't responsible for the cleanup. Mobile is.
Yes.
In that situation, if it is mobile, if it's a mobile station. With this bylaw, they have more power to go after mobile. But what I really wanted to get at is, this is a general bylaw that you're bringing before town meeting. This is just for a discussion. This is not for us to vote on.
Right,
no.
There's no action by the planning board.
So it's just for us to have information. If you want to get more information, you can absolutely get more information. But this is Mr. Westling is just here to give us the information that, hey, I'm going to go before town meeting with this general bylaw.
And we want you to be aware.
He's not asking for our blessings.
Okay.
He doesn't need your blessing. It's a general bylaw.
Okay.
However, the planning board, Mr. Chairman, the planning board is the administrator and implementer and enforcer. However, any powers may be delegated in writing to either the Department of Public Works, the Board of Health, the Conservation Commission. If I may follow up, Mr. Chairman, on something that Mr. Kistner was saying. Today, there may be pollutants in that culvert that are not being detected.
Right.
So what this does, this actually requires, through the MS4 permit and the bylaw that we have, it requires us to sample that. So that culvert, all catch basins across town and all outlets, to see if there are pollutants in there.
Sure.
Currently, today, there's nothing that requires us to do that, and we don't do that for the majority of our outfalls, unless we suspect a problem.
Sure.
So this actually requires us to make those observations, dry weather and wet weather, and to do sampling to check for certain pollutants.
Through the chair. So will that drive up costs for the
Yes.
People are coming for permits?
For people that are coming for permits, I would say not necessarily, because you still have to, this doesn't change anything, you still have to protect the wetlands during construction, you still have to protect it after construction, you still have to comply with Clean Waters Act, with Conservation Commission requirements. This puts more burden and financial responsibility on the town through the Department of Public Works. And through Central Mass Regional Stormwater Coalition, which is a coalition of 31 different towns throughout Central Mass, we had an engineer come out, and she estimated what the total new costs would be. So our budget increased dramatically this year to conform to the Phase 1 requirements, because we've got to hire someone to go out, make those inspections, make those observations, make those reports, make those sampling, hire a laboratory to do the testing. So it's a very cumbersome law that that we have to comply with.
And I'll tell you, every town in the region is complaining about that extra cost, and it's kind of an unfunded mandate, but it comes directly down from the feds, where they are enforcing basically what the requirements were, the law that you got to keep no illicit stuff,
right.
But they just never sampled for it. Well, now they're saying, hey, you got to sample for it. So that person on Thayer Heights that walks their dog and picks up the dog waste and puts it in a nice little paper bag and throws it into the storm sewer, we're coming to get you.
Is that the cost being the $300,000 you alluded to before? Is that the cost we were talking about, $300,000 roughly?
Yes, and that's for all of our operations that we do to conform to this. That includes street sweeping, that includes catch basin cleaning and disposal of the materials.
Yeah. Would the street sweeping increase?
Yes, significantly.
Because right now we currently sweep our streets once per year.
Okay.
We currently clean our catch basins once per year. Depending upon which...
And a few years ago we didn't clean them that often.
Right. So depending upon which of the basins that we're in, we may have to do that more frequently than once per year. If there are basins that are found to fill up, which basically eliminates their ability to take out a lot of the sediment, then we may have to clean those twice, four times per year.
More than the catch basin cleaning and the street sweeping? Are there other things that we have to increase the frequency of? Or?
Certainly observations of the outfalls, sampling, testing,
that would be the new position you're talking about, right?
Well, not the new position, but the new financial burden on the town.
Okay.
We likely wouldn't hire a person as a full-time employee. We would hire a consulting group or a laboratory to come in. We have over 2,300 catch basins. I don't want to estimate. I think we have over 600 of outfalls, all which have to be observed dry weather, wet weather, sampled during wet weather. And again, if we find, let's say we find a problem at the bottom of Cedar Street where that discharge pipe outlets into the swamp. Let's say it's petroleum based. We have to track all the way back up through until we find that source. And it may not be obvious like the gas stations.
Right.
Maybe someone who's changing their oil up behind, up off of Hayden Row that has dumped it into a catch basin.
So it's a big unknown, the mitigation.
The elimination is going to be problematic.
But if it makes you feel any better, compare yourself to a town like Boston, right?
Sure.
I mean, didn't this happen a lot in the past in Boston, that there was problems with stormwater?
Yeah.
Charles River Basin has gotten hit really hard, I believe, which we're part of it, part of that area. They have really tough regs.
In a non-residential area.
Well, Ken, you're part of that board, aren't you?
Yeah. I'm on the Water Resources Board, and Clean Water Act is where we get all of our authority. And there are folks that are much more environmental than I am, and I guess I consider myself a practical environmentalist, but that are on that board that they would scare you.
A lot of people critique this permit and say it doesn't go far enough.
Yeah. There's several members of my board are that way. One of them's the president of the Charles River Watershed and executive director.
That's the extremist. Let's start with something and build off it, right?
Yeah.
Well, and that's that point, I just want to make clear that the reason why I'm bringing that up is because I don't want any person or persons
to be caught in the middle of a quagmire that causes them hardship because of this change that has to come about. And it does have to come about, because I'm as green as anybody else is, but the situation is that where does the onus lie on that, and how do we execute that onus?
You, Mr. Chair.
Yeah.
Cliff, I don't think innocent people are going to be paying money. It's, if you're polluting, you're going to be responsible for it, and that's the way it should be. So I think you're over worrying, in my opinion.
It's
a good concern, but
the other good part is Hopkinson's on the top of the hill, so nobody's flowing down into us.
Again, I want to reinforce, Mr. Chairman, that this is the new law that becomes effective July 1st of this year. We have to have a new notice of intent submitted by September of this year, and if we're not in conformance, then we run up against all kinds of problems with the
funding and everything
with the EPA and with DEP if we're in non-compliance with a federal law.
Mr. Chair, just a quick note. I think there's maybe an invalid reference on page 5, John. Maybe I'm wrong, but on number 5 under C, it's pointing back to Article 3, Section 6B, and should that be 7B? Is it pointing to right above?
Section 6B.
I'm sorry. So page 5.
Section C, non-criminal disposition. See Article 3, Section 6B.
Yep.
Is that right above it that's talking about? Because if so, that's 7B. If I'm reading that correctly.
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
Just a typo kind of thing.
Yep.
Somebody probably added a section and didn't update the reference.
Right.
Why you pass these in advance.
Okay. It looked to me like this was not completely fully written, per se. There's a few paragraphs that look like there was kind of summarized as maybe.
Correct.
So, okay.
Point of order?
Yeah, go ahead.
Question of the point of order. Is this an actual article that's moved forward for town meeting?
We are not. He is sponsoring an article.
Sure, but this is an actual, we don't know the article number or anything like that. Right.
We do not know the article number at this point, because I don't think that's been set by the selectmen at this point, and this will probably change wording-wise a little bit, but I think the intent is what he's trying to do here.
So at some point or another, we will consider supporting it as a board or not, and this is not the time?
We do not have to support or we do not have to make a recommendation, because it's a general bylaw. I mean, we could support it per se.
Do we do that now, or would that at a later date?
We could say general support, and the reason why we would maybe want to do that is we are the enforcer, acting like, you know, the paragraph from Powers.
And I second French motion.
Well, I still have a question that I need to ask to the
why don't we take it up at right before town meeting when we get the final one in front of us?
Okay, that answers my question. Thank you.
That's okay.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. And we've got a couple other ones we haven't gone all the way with our support yet. So we'll do that at the same time.
Sure. I think the DPW would welcome that, right? To the planning board.
It would only be helpful.
Yes. And to the end of this now is that on number 9 under pollutants on page 3, you have rock, sand, salt, and soils. So, am I correct in assuming that the town does sanding and rock and salt on the roads, and though that runoff, it contributes to a lot of that waste inclusively?
Through the chair, so we do spread salt, and not so much anymore sand, on our roads. But that would, that's why we have to go out and we have to sweep the streets of any sand or salt. We have to clean the catch basins of any sand or salt. We can't let that build up to the point where it's just overflowing the sump of a catch basin into a stream, because then we're in violation of not only this, but also just the good housekeeping practices that we have stated that we will follow.
So we have residents in town complaining about runoff going into the watersheds that we have, the lakes that we have. Lake Maspinock, Lake Whitehall, and a lot of it is attributed to salt and pretreatment of the roads is runoff. Yes?
Not that I'm aware of.
Well, yes.
Yes.
There's been letters in the hot news in particular. But I think the answer to Cliff's question, if you don't, maybe we're not on the same page, John, but the basins and infiltration basins along near Lake Whitehall were getting filled from a construction project, and then that caused DPW to have to clean them out more often. And there was questions back in the day, would the developer pay for it or the town pay for it? And it was so long after the developer had vanished
disappeared.
That the DPW had to pick up extra work cleaning catch basins that were blocking.
But isn't salt soluble?
Yes, but that's not what I heard you say, that we've got complaints about people, from people.
There were complaints a few years back, yes.
Okay.
And, also through the Water Preservation Committee, I guess, I might be quoting that wrong, they about the weed control in the lakes that are going on, and they feel a lot of it was due to pesticides and road salt from winter road preparations. So if I'm recollecting correctly, that was a big concern for the people that check the waters for Maspinock and Whitehall.
Through the chairman, I am staff support to the Lake Maspinock Weed Management Advisory Committee that was put together based on a town meeting vote of 2 years ago.
I think it was, yeah.
And that committee and also the environmental scientist and certified lake manager and limnologist that we hired, they didn't point to any need to change our sanding or salting of the roadways as it affects weeds.
Can I ask a question through the chair? And it's maybe sideways to this. You mentioned we're only using salt now. Well, why is that not sand-salt combination?
Through the chairman, much bigger conversation.
For sure.
A lot of communities are moving to all salt, and the state uses all salt. And the reason for that is severalfold. One, it's a tremendous cost savings to the town. We don't have to purchase the sand. We don't have to handle the sand multiple times. We don't have to mix it. We don't have to sweep up as much sand in the spring. We don't have to clean out as many catch basins or as much material out of those basins. If you just take a look when you leave, before the snow comes tomorrow, when you're driving home, notice that we don't have the sand mounded up in the center of the roadway and on the edge of the roadway like we used to. That stays out of the catch basins. That then stays out of, when they fill up and they overflow, it stays out of the wetlands and the streams. And what we did is we actually had our equipment calibrated so that we're putting out what's recommended for appropriate snow and ice removal and treatment. So through the calibration of our trucks, we're putting out as much salt as we were previously, if not less. We've cut back on a lot of the settings on the vehicles, on the trucks that are spreading the salt. So when we spread sand and salt, the sand does absolutely nothing to take care of the snow or ice.
It's for traction, right?
It provides temporary traction. If it's windy, it blows off the roadway, and it only provides traction where those two, or if it's a two-lane road, where the four wheel grooves are. Once the vehicles go over it a few times, the angular properties of sand, they become rounded. Mm-hmm. You no longer have that traction, so you're spreading sand across the entire width of the roadway. I told you it was a much bigger conversation. You're spreading sand across the entire width of the roadway, and it's providing no traction. So we've reduced the cost of our snow and ice treatment through the winter. We're saving the town funds. We're saving the environment. So, much bigger picture.
Thank you for an excellent answer and research on this year.
Okay, last. I got one more through the chair. I bike ride a lot, and I went over on Winter Street, and I've noticed that it's a downhill run from the top of Winter all the way down around Whitehall, and it circles around that whole basin there. And I had a video that I took. The road slants as it turns corners. It slants, and on the opposite side of the downslant, there are no curbs to make the water run off down the curb berm. And so what I took a video of was the erosion of the soil that is on the edge of the road, and I watched a river of water running from Winter Street off the road through the whole woods and people's properties down into the lake. And I literally took a video of it, and I'm saying this is what we're paying all this money for, is for water protection on the lakes, but here is a huge contributor of that. If you're putting salt on the road, that salt either dries up on the road and stays there until it's done, and then it's picked up by rainwater, which is also fed into that runoff, and that runoff goes right into the lake. So I can't see how we don't have someone that goes out and investigates those aspects that are causing a great disearnest to the lakes where out of sight, out of mind. There should be a berm there to catch as the road slants.
Why don't you follow up with John and show him?
Are there catch basins on that road?
No, there are not.
So there's no sense in tunneling it down with a curb if it's got no place to go.
Oh well, I don't know how many down further down the hill, but it's a run down the hill. So what ends up happening is, as the road weaves around the way it does.
Why don't I suggest you take it offline with John?
Okay.
The planning board only has responsibility for new roads.
And through the chairman, we have miles and miles of roadway where there is no berm, and we sometimes get a concentration of the water runoff where it does channelize, and we typically go out and we put in gravel or a heavier material so it won't wash out. But the ultimate discharge point, as was mentioned, the ultimate discharge point is the same. So happy to look at it offline with you to see what we can do to either protect the edge of the road or take other steps there.
One quick follow-up to the chair.
Yeah.
I've noticed that you have, in certain places, put sections of curb, like maybe 20, 30, 40, 50 feet. Is that an outside consultant that we have to, vendor that we have to do that, or we can do that on our own?
We do that on our own.
Okay. I thought we didn't have a berm machine.
We do.
Oh, we do. Okay.
Yeah.
So that I thought we were talking about building our own sidewalks. The decision was that we didn't have our own berm-making machine.
No, we've had our own berm machine. Okay. I think we bought it from Chapter 90 funds 2 or 3 years ago.
Thank you.
But the building sidewalks has nothing to do with having a berm machine or not. It's having the construction too, having the equipment, having the manpower, having the time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Understood.
Can I make one statement, Ken?
Yeah, and then we got to get going.
I completely support this and look forward to any revisions that come forward to us. This functionally, when we got notice that this was coming, I wasn't sure what would be in it, but I was kind of hoping that it would address one of Cliff's concerns with the lake area, where a lot of people are putting fertilizers down that aren't allowed, and where, sure, that's against the law, but there's no inspections and no one going after, say, don't do this, because fertilizers are one of the things that are affecting the lake. So I think this is great for giving power to this situation, storm runoff. I was kind of hoping there'd be something about storm runoff around like Maspinock specifically.
Okay.
Would that be something that's in the works, or is that something that's...
Through the chair, this covers all of our drainage infrastructure, but I'm not aware of any law that prevents you from fertilizing your lawn.
All the properties alongside Lake Maspinock are not allowed to use fertilizers.
And whose law is that?
I'm not sure that...
It's a bylaw that the Conservation Commission has to enforce.
So then I would speak to the Conservation Commission. If there's an existing law, as you stated, on the books that isn't being enforced, that's through the Conservation Commission. But I know that there are properties there that do fertilize. So that's a conversation.
I have seen the signs on Fruit Street over by the wells that says that fertilizer is not allowed to be used. I don't know whether who put them up, who supports it, who enforces it. But.
So, if it's in the 400 feet, probably. You're not supposed to do anything in the 400 feet. Zone 1.
Yeah, so this
different subject, because I was talking about within the well.
Yeah, this wouldn't identify lawn fertilizer as an illicit discharge.
I mean, every project I worked on on a conservation commission that was a lakeside property, every one of them had a stipulation that there would be no fertilizers on the property. So
it might be part of their order of conditions. Maybe it might not be a bylaw.
Whatever the situation is, if that being the case, would this bylaw affect that kind of lakeside situation?
No.
Actually, John, number 5 does say pesticides are the size of fertilizers.
Yes, it says that, but that was only if it got into a drainage spot.
Right.
If you fertilize the back of your lot and it just went off the breakwater, that's not it. Something you're going to catch.
And if you, the fertilizer, when we do our sampling, there are, again, components that we have to sample for, and we don't sample to find out if you use Scott's turf builder. It would be a component within that, that, for example, if it were of a concentration strong enough, it would be likely that someone hired Chemlon and the truck spilled its contents into a catch basin,
which would be illicit,
or dumped them there.
Yeah, this doesn't. This does correct. Yeah. This doesn't prevent people from fertilizing their lawns.
Okay,
but just one more bite at that sapple. If there is a bylaw, and there's certainly orders and conditions all along the Lake Mastodon about people not using fertilizer, and they are using fertilizer, stormwater runoff into the lake is a concern. So why wouldn't this not cover this new bylaw not cover that?
Because the federal government doesn't require that.
Yeah, and this doesn't capture all other
entities,
laws, bylaws, regulations, orders of conditions, and incorporate them all into this. This is its own freestanding. And again, that Lake Mastodon Weed Management Advisory Group. I know that we were looking at people using herbicides. Fertilizers around existing, in this case, the lake, and that never came up as it was a prohibited use. So something to follow up with the Conservation Commission.
Okay, let's thank you, John.
John, thank you.
I know you're going to be working hard for the next 24 hours or so, and good luck. Sorry to keep you so late.
Thank you very much. Appreciate your time.
Yep.
Thank you.
Okay, the next order of business is to set the performance bond and sign a Form K for Hens Farm subdivision. That was the subdivision off of Ash Street.
Yes.
And what is the recommendation for the bond amount?
So we had Luckner Bias review it, and he came back with $21,200. Brian didn't argue that amount. The only thing I would ask or say is that typically you also include another $5,000 for legal costs. So I guess that would bring it up to $26,200.
Entertain a motion to set the performance bond amount to $26,200.
So moved.
Second.
Moved in second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. And then the second is a motion to sign the Form 10 K. Sign the Form K for the
Lots 2 and 3.
For lots 2 and 3. This would be the lot release subject to the bond.
Receipt of bond in appropriate satisfactory condition.
Okay, so the motion to sign the Form K. Move.
Second.
Second. Further discussion? Seeing none. How do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. And we need a bunch of signatures on this one.
Please. At least.
Pass it that way, and then you can pass it back. Okay, master plan implementation. Where are we?
So I've been following up and tracking down all the committees that needed to respond to us with their pieces of the implementation plan. Got everybody except the Board of Selectmen and the Historic Commission. The Historic Commission only has one item.
Is this the District Commission or the Historic?
No, I got the District.
Gotcha.
Needed Historic Commission, which is Mike Rohan.
Yep.
I've sent him an email again, following up again. And then the Board of Selectmen had it scheduled for their previous meeting, but then it went too long, so they continued it. But then some issues came up that they had to hold it. They were supposed to hold a public hearing tomorrow night, but now that's been canceled because of the weather. So it looks like it's going to at least be not until March, their March meeting, which will be the 28th, or their first meeting in April before the Selectmen come back to us.
Okay, but they're working on it.
They're working on it. Elaine and I went through it, made recommendations for the Selectmen, so they're basically just going to go through it and say whether or not they agree with
okay.
the recommendations.
Great. So we're making progress. We want to get that thing done as soon as we can.
Yes.
Okay, next thing is the Legacy Farms North update.
Weather.
Right. John recommended that we...
John recommended that we postpone.
So he's saying that they need more than
a week.
6 days to...
No, I think what he's saying is there's going to be a lot of snow left that day. So if we were going to try to do something out there, we'd be stepping in snow and slush, probably, and it might just not be the most nice thing. And we'll have to resend out some invitations and stuff like that. But
the majority haven't gone out yet.
It might be worth it to do it in spring-like weather, right?
Yeah. Now, the state official, Juan Vega, secretary, deputy assistant secretary, I think, he's coming out to speak. He's available that day. He said it's up to us to make that determination. But we will have to coordinate another date, you know, with them. So it's kind of, what I'll do is, while I'm sitting warm and snug by the fire tomorrow, I'll give Mr. McDowell a call and we'll talk about it. And I think we're going to postpone it. I think we're going that way. And Jennifer, I'll send you an email one way or the other. And
Is there much work that he needs to do in order to do the ribbon cutting, or functionally it's...
He's got a couple of signs to be placed that have not been placed, and then he doesn't have a lot of physical work on it. He's got a couple of cleanup things that we assigned him to, and then there's a list of, making sure we got some coffee and light refreshments, and we've got speeches pretty well lined up, and Roy's got to provide a big piece of ribbon. We're providing, all of us are bringing our own scissors.
Did you see that the ribbon cutting into the future buildings will have a drinking permit?
We'll have a
liquor license.
Well, we're not going to do.
But I'm going to drive home.
Yeah.
9:30 in the morning?
Yeah.
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 Got to drive home,
so,
too.
Anyway, we'll make that call tomorrow.
Got to drive down.
But you'll have plenty of time because it is until next week. But and we'll try to find a better date if that's. I think the concern is just how much snow is going to be left. And also, I need to talk with Western Nurseries because they're doing the parking, and that's the commercial sales. And they said no problem for this date in March, but there's a date where they start filling that all up with goods that are going to be sold. So I got to talk to Peter before
that day
we.
Is sometime in April too.
I'm sure it is.
Right. So.
So I that might be a portion, you know. So maybe.
Hard stop.
We'll probably have a hard stop, and everyone wants to kind of get the road open because it will be a good thing.
Just to elaborate on the weather, though, when I checked the forecast, it's going to be pretty cold for the next week, or all the way up to that point.
So, so that's not going to melt off, is what?
If we get 2 feet, it's not going to be melting.
Yeah. And right now, it's saying
plans of let's do a nice day in October, a nice fall day in October.
And those one by the wayside.
Yeah. Okay. October.
Next Tuesday is projected to be 44 degrees.
Yeah.
But what about before that?
All right, next.
That's okay. Not supposed to go above 32 degrees for the next seven days, this weekend. I think.
Yeah. Two snowstorms. In between now and then.
Okay, and we don't want to get too far in April because then we're running into conflicts with marathon activities and everything too.
Right.
So, okay, for goals update, I don't think we had anything to take on tonight. Let's approve the minutes for the 13th of February 2017. Are there any comments, questions to the minutes?
I have a change, please.
Okay.
What page?
No. The reason I walked out was not mentioned, and on page 2, page 3, top of the page, after the point where I was told to talk to Mr. Westring offline, that I had asked a question about the materials and cost that would be used, could be used, and then another member asked another question, and before I got my answer, that's when the chair decided to cut communication on that, and then allowed Mr. Paul to ask another question about finance of the project.
Unrelated.
That was related to the project. And I felt that was unfair, that's why I left in protest. I just wanted to be clear about that, and I was pretty clear when I left that I said the same thing. Sure. So I'd like to see the minutes reflect my statement that why I left. That makes sense? Want me to write it up?
You can write it up for me, please. Right.
Okay, with the change, anyone else have anything?
Just a further comment that just came back to me now, that the conversation for Chamberlain sidewalks had gone on for a long time, and my question was the switch of gears to the finances. That's kind of why I think Ken said yes to one. And Chestnut, sorry. That was my assumption that he said yes to, in order to move on to a different talking point within.
Okay. Ready to approve the minutes? Entertain a motion to approve the minutes with Frank's additions.
So moved.
Second.
Seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
And thank you. We're all volunteers, and I know sometimes we can mostly agree on things, so I appreciate your patience with me. Thank you.
Yeah, I will note that we were 20-plus minutes late on that meeting, getting out of here, if I remember correctly. It probably even says here when we adjourned.
Yeah,
20 minutes late.
I'm for overtime on that.
Okay. So did I.
We can be out of here before 9.
I was at the beach, so.
Yeah.
I did watch it when I got home.
Next item. Our April 10th meeting, which is a Monday, which is the first night of Passover, is not the right thing to do. That is also going to be a hearing night, possibly for the Chamberlain Wayland subdivision. So I think it's important for all our members to potentially be here, and also members of the public that might, you know, have religious reasons not to do there. If we did Wednesday, that would be the 12th. Is that possible?
Of March?
No, April.
I mean April. Yeah, that's what I meant.
I'm fine with any day.
That works for me.
That works.
Yeah.
I'll be in Boston that day, probably pretty late.
And I mean, obviously without Fran and John, we don't know their schedules.
What about Thursday, then we end up, that's Catholics are busy on Thursday night, I believe.
I don't know if it matters, but we're starting to get close to marathon, too, so I don't know if that matters to you guys or not, but is it marathon
the
17th?
Yeah.
Yep.
So yeah. Okay. I'm not extremely religious, but first day of Passover, is that what it is?
Yeah, yeah. That's a biggie.
Yeah,
big
it starts, day. Yeah.
Yeah. Might so, I also recommend we change the venue?
Yes. Yes, I think...
Well, that's how this started, because I was going to switch us to over there with conservation, and they're like, well, we're not meeting that night because it's Passover. And I said, oh, good to know. Thanks.
I'm thinking of the library. Yeah. More room than just that.
We just find out when they reschedule theirs to, and we'll switch it with them.
I was also given the opportunity from HCAM to use their studios, which has actually probably got a better... I mean, we want it on TV, obviously, because... So it's really the school library. I believe they can also set up in the auditorium at the school. So why don't Jennifer and I work on this over the next couple of days, because we've got to post this hearing. And we'll try for the, I guess, the 12th.
So that meeting on the 10th is can't. You want me to cancel that regardless?
I think we at this point it's going to be the 12th, and where we're going to have to figure out. But this room will not work.
No,
no.
And we already found that out.
Board of Appeals is meeting next door.
So let's try either HCAM or see if we can get a school. Thank you. Our next meeting...
Again, while we're talking about rescheduling, let's look at the 12th, but let's look at some other dates, too. The April 3rd, April 5th.
We can't do April 3rd, too, so we don't have enough time to advertise at this point.
Okay.
Sorry. And we can push it out to the 24th,
we already
which
have.
Is our regular scheduled meeting. We have that Saddle Hill
subdivision.
Subdivision.
And quite frankly, both of these are going to take more than one hearing to
anyway,
Saddle Hill.
What about the 17th
is
an option?
It's a holiday. It's Marathon Monday. Mm. Well, it's Patriots Day.
Right. School vacation.
In this town, it's Marathon school. Monday. Yes.
What about the 18th?
It's school vacation week.
It's okay.
I can't. I designed a reboard that night, so I can't. But you don't need me. So.
Yes, we do.
Okay,
yes.
Elaine.
Okay. Okay. We'll work on that one.
Just let us send out an email to you for whatever date we decide. Yeah. We can say yes.
We'll make sure that we have as many people as we can get here. Okay.
Question about future meetings. If we're still.
Yeah. Go ahead. Yep.
Can somebody just give me a, anybody in the know about that Saddle Hill Road, what the proposal is for development?
It's for an open space subdivision for 19 lots off
18.
Corners. 18 lots, I'm sorry. On
19,
Saddle,
19 Hybo.
On Saddle Hill and Proctor Lane, Proctor Road.
Oh, Proctor and Cross. Cross. The lower part of it?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
The part near 495 or the part near?
Aren't you over there, David?
The other side.
Aren't you
at the
four
way stop.
How many
houses?
Walker
there
Street,
when
you go
yeah.
through.
That's
pretty
crowded already
there. There is. But that's that.
It's a really nice wooded area right now.
I just love
for long.
For long. Wetlands. It's wetlands now.
Solar panels.
Yeah, they're getting a delineation with conservation right now.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, we've got a couple
so,
of... We got
before you go off that topic, I'm sorry, I'm confused. So are we aiming for the 12th?
We're aiming for the 12th. But we'll, maybe we send a note to John and Fran and see where they are.
Okay, because, yeah, I just also want to make sure that we have the board members that are going to be here after the election, just in case it goes past that and we lose board members.
Well, we might not have... Because
we need at least six.
I know, and there's four of us up for re-election, so...
Right.
Can I just ask a question?
Sure.
Because they can come. I know that they can come. They're allowed to come. But why are we having a public hearing for Chamberlain, Whalen, and Saddle Hill when there's going to be a new board on May 15th, a month later?
Because they filed it early enough to get on. I've already had calls about the fact that it's been pushed out too late for that.
Right.
So,
I mean,
but I said, but we don't have, I don't, I mean, this is as early as I could do them both.
Right.
If you want, I could try to see if they'll wait till after the election and pose the question.
We have posed that question when we met with them.
But they hadn't filed yet, so I don't know. We didn't know. I mean, I can try it again and see and tell them we're having some scheduling issues. But.
And it's two positions on the board that may or may not change, right?
There are four.
Four of us
are up for
likely election. Likely or... Because some people may not be run.
Right.
I mean, it's likely that, I mean, Saddle Hill Road is going to go past the election, I would imagine, right?
Well, we might want to talk to them to see whether or not realistic. Well, no. What we're doing for both of these, because they're open space, is just the special permit aspect. It's not the final design, per se. It's approval of the concept. This is kind of where the roads are going to go,
subject
to... You know, there's no engineering, full engineering done at this point. This is just, you're comfortable with whatever concept.
So it's only the start of the process.
It's the start of the process. And the second one is it can be done with the new board afterwards.
Thank you.
Yeah, they don't want to put a lot of engineering into this piece of it. Because if this doesn't pass, then
they've
got to redesign.
And that's the way the bylaw is set up, too, is to... You do a baby step, get approval, and then, you know, put the hard engineering in. But
I mean, I'll ask them if they'll put weight off, but I don't think they will. But I'll ask them.
I sense not either, but they might run the risk that they get it duplicated, just like Mr. McDowell ended up this last year. And it is a concern. Yeah. Okay, and. Any other things that we need to be looking at? Given that, I don't know who won the wager, but I'll accept a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and second. On the motion to adjourn, all those in favor say yes.
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 And be careful on the snow tomorrow.
I don't know, you all saw Elaine's email that the economic development survey thing is
canceled
tomorrow.
Be careful if you're shoveling or even blowing snow, particularly some of us that, you know, bend at the knees. Take careful. It is not good from a heart attack standpoint.
Do not discharge your snow into a culvert cliff.
My son conveniently broke his collarbone too. So.